Hello everyone, good afternoon to all of you. Myself Deshashwati. On behalf of IEEE SJC-WIE, I would like to welcome you all to this Kalpana Chawla Memorial Talk. IEEE SJC is one of the most active and highly respected technical clubs of SJC, which was established in the year 1991. Since then, it is in the forefront of providing technical education to students and bridging the gap between academy and industry. We have more than 200 IEEE members and numerous volunteers. WIE, a wing of IEEE SJC, is engaged in a lot of humanitarian as well as technical activities with the aim of providing equitable education. As we all know, the word satellite is a household name today. It sounds so familiar to everyone, irrespective of educational and professional background. It is no longer prerogative to a few select nations and not a topic that is confined to the premises of big academic institutes and research organizations. It is now a subject of interest to a large extent everyone. So to enlighten us, now I take the privilege to welcome today's speaker, Mrs. N. Valarmati, who has acknowledged our invitation to give the talk today. We all welcome you to the talk room. I would also like to welcome Dr. M. G. Veena, Student Runs Counselor, IEEE SJCE for the talk. We also have our WIE advisor, Professor Supritha M, who has been a constant support for our events. Welcome to the talk, ma'am. I would also like to welcome Dr. Sudarshan Patil Kulkarni, Vice Chairperson, IEEE Mysuru Subsection, to the talk. Welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
Finally, I welcome all the enthusiastic learners for making time and attending this talk. Welcome, guys. So let's get started. Firstly, I request Veena ma'am to kindly introduce the speaker to all of us.
Thank you, Shashwati. Bowing to the lotus feet of Mahaswamiji, I take this opportunity to welcome N. Valarmati, outstanding scientist, deputy director, ISRO. N. Valarmati, an outstanding scientist in ISRO, retired as deputy director, UR Rao Satellite Center, one of the major centers of the Indian Space Research Organization located in Bangalore. Madam graduated in Electronics and Telecommunications Engineering from Madras University, Tamil Nadu, and obtained her ME in Communication Systems from Anna University, Tamil Nadu. She has joined ISRO in 1984 and functioned in various capacities since then. She has contributed significantly to various spacecrafts of ISRO, starting from IRS-1A. Her career started with development of test systems, associated software, and testing of the spacecraft till launch. She held various responsibilities in the project team and has the unique distinction of having worked on all the three kinds of satellites, that is, communication satellite, optical remote sensing satellite, and microwave remote sensing satellite. She was the project director of RISAT-1 radar imaging satellite, India's indigenously built active microwave remote sensing satellite with many new technologies. She supported the satellite programs underway. Various functional responsibilities group and deputy director of controls and digital area program director of microwave remote sensing satellite program and deputy director of payload data management and space astronomy area. She has been conferred with ISRO Merit Award 2011, Team Excellence Award for the year 2012 for RISAT and Performance Excellence Award for the year 2018. She has been presented with Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam Award for contribution in the field of development of science, humanities, and welfare of studies by Tamil Nadu government. She is a fellow of IETE, life member of Astronautical Society of India and Indian Society of Remote Sensing, ISRS. I welcome you, ma'am. And I give this dais to you so that you can take over. Thank you.
Good afternoon to all. Faculty members, students, and all other participants, I am very glad to be present on this occasion and also speak about my area. Can I put my presentation material?
Yes, ma'am, I stop presenting.
Just 1 minute. You are able to see the presentation?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. First of all, very warm welcome to all the IEEE members and other participants. Thank you very much. This is Saturday afternoon. Let us be our post lunch section. So let us all be brisk for another 40 minutes. Let us enjoy whatever I am going to present to you and also the interaction with you. Now, in today's lecture, I am going to cover you the basic things and also some of the things in detail. So we will start with the overview of satellite, what it means and what is the background, and satellite realization, how it is conceptually visualized, and also the different stages of realization till launch, and the classification of the satellites, and what are the different satellites and its applications, and what is ahead in stock, and what is my view in conclusion. So before starting, just I want to give an overview of ISRO. All of you must be aware of ISRO, one of the very popular research organization. It stands for Indian Space Research Organization. I will bring to your notice that what are the major centers we have and what are the major activities which are being taken up in ISRO. First of all, being an Indian, we should be very much proud that India is capable of using space for many applications. Indigenously, it can do wonders in space. This is an introduction I wanted to give it to you people. See, the thing is that we have got a space application center which is located in Ahmedabad. It is capable of making so many payloads, sensors, whatever you want, whether it is for communication purpose, navigation purpose, or remote sensing purpose, all sensors are made in space application center. Then number two, if you see URO satellite center, which is located in Bangalore, we make the satellites. The payload is delivered to satellite, and all other systems from other various centers like sensors, actuators, propulsion, that is fuel tank, everything is coming to URO satellite center, and we assemble the satellite. This satellite is taken to Satish Dhawan Space Center in Sriharikota, where the launch vehicle, either it is a PSLV or GSLV, which is made in Vikram Sarabhai Space Center in Trivandrum. It is mated with the launch vehicle at the Satish Dhawan Space Center. Now today, if you look back from Satish Dhawan Space Center, we have been launching all the satellites irrespective of remote sensing or communication. And for your information, we have got launch vehicle PSLV, GSLV, Mark 1, Mark 2, Mark 3, and sometimes we have got we used to launch sounding rockets also. Now after launch, the satellite in space is being controlled by satellite control center. For communication satellite, it is in Harsan, MCF. And for remote sensing satellite, the control center is located in Bangalore, ISRO. Okay, now the spacecraft is put in space and it has been monitored by the control center. Now, from the spacecraft, we have to get the useful data, no? That data is being received in Hyderabad, National Remote Sensing Center. And all received data are processed in the remote sensing center, I mean National Remote Sensing Center, and it has been disseminated to all the users for various applications. Now you can visualize the satellite, how it is being made and what is the chain or networks involved in that till its use is reaching the user. And in to support all these things, we have got various research center in throughout India, and this information you can get it from our ISRO website. Now I am going to touch upon that is satellites and its application by the center, which is being highlighted in pink color. Now you could imagine ISRO, how big the organization is and what varieties of activities are being carried out and how successfully we are able to serve the nation and also the society. So let us talk about satellites and its application subsequently. Now, to start with, everyone should be aware what is a satellite. We study many things, and then naturally, if you see, moon is a satellite for our Earth. Like that, most of the planets are having their own satellites. That is, any body that moves around another one in a mathematically predictable form is called a satellite. So by nature, we have got a moon for us as a satellite. In addition, whatever we are sending to space, which will be revolving around the Earth, or if it has got its mathematically predictable path, they are all called man-made satellites. Now, when I talk about satellite, you must be wondering this technology, when it would have been initiated. See, for example, if you talk about aircraft, I can tell in 1903, the Wright brothers, they have started the research on building the aircraft. Now, as far as satellite is concerned, the satellite technology started since 1957. The first artificial satellite, Sputnik 1, it was launched by Soviet Union in 1957. That means more or less around 50-60 years people are working in this area. Now, these satellites are classified in many categories. How? Based on the applications. There is no limit for the application, which you will come to know after some time. So today, if you see, around 6,000 satellites plus are in orbit. In that, some may not work, some are very actively working. All 6,000 satellites are put for some applications by many countries. Now, generally, the satellites are made for the requirements given by the user, and it is launched in space by the launch vehicle. When we talk about satellite, we need not worry about its resources. It has got its own resources. For example, it has got its own fuel, it has got its own power, it has got its own communication systems. So all resources are available for its operation. So when we are telling about our ISRO, our activities and other things, it is not only in ISRO. If you see internationally, we have got so many space agencies. See, for example, all are aware, NASA in USA, Roscosmos in Russia, and China Space Agency in Japan is also JAXA, Europe, it is called ESA, Canadian Space Agency, CANES in Germany, UK space agencies, Italian space agencies. In addition, we have got so many private agencies. I think totally around 50 to 60 space agencies are existing. So when we talk about satellite components, that's why I told the resources. Let us go little in detail about satellite. So satellite has got its own structure, like how we have, even though in our house, we have got a small, small utility area. The main is the total, the structure of the house. Similar to that, we have got a structure of a satellite. That satellite has got all other small, small systems accommodated inside or outside the structure. Now, for example, if you want to deploy solar array, we have want a mechanism. If you want to deploy an antenna, we want a mechanism for that. So all related elements are housed inside the structure. If you see, when it is in space, half of the spacecraft sometimes will see sun, half will see the deep cold sky. So there will be a temperature gradient in the spacecraft. So to control that, all should work at the same the design temperatures. Whatever window we have planned for its operation, it has to be put in that particular window. For that, we have got some heaters, some sensors, which is which constitutes the thermal system that is also housed in that inside the structure. Now coming to propulsion system. So we want to control the altitude of this spacecraft or attitude of the spacecraft. All those things, and the propulsion system has got its own fuel, and it has got one small, small rocket. They are all called thrusters. By firing them, we are able to control its altitude and also attitude. Now, to keep all the systems work in, actively, we need power systems. The power systems, once if you go up in space, it has to generate its own power. It is being done by solar panels. Imagine if the spacecraft is not seeing the sun, it is in eclipse. So we need batteries to support the spacecraft. If there is no external power, it has to be supported internally by the battery. Switching from solar arrays to battery, we need a control electronics. So it is called power control electronics. All these portions are housed within the structure. Now, we have sent the spacecraft up. We want to tell the spacecraft what it has to do, and the spacecraft has to inform us what it has done. So for that, we have got communication system. Communication system has got its own receiver to receive our command. It has got its own transmitter to send it back. To support these things, it has got its own antenna. All the systems are put inside the spacecraft. Now, onboard controller. Of course, many individual systems, they have to do their work, but there should not be any clash among them. So we need a controller to command each system to organize the total functions of the spacecraft. And some of the things it has to take autonomous way also. So all the powerful things, it has got its own software, hardware, logics, so many things are housed within the onboard controller. It is the heart of the total spacecraft. Now, coming to sensors, whenever the spacecraft is in space, the spacecraft has its location details, where it is there in space. So with respect to this is derived based on some references. Main references are Earth and Sun, then stars. So these sensors, they will take the reference from these external bodies, and it will send the information to ground. Based on that, we want to maintain the stability of the spacecraft. Actuators are used. Actuator is nothing but wheels, thrusters, all those things, what will happen by rotating the proper actuators, we achieve the stability of the platform. Then payload. Payload only what I have told, communication systems, means it has got its own relay station or transponder. If it is a remote sensing satellite, we need a camera, we need optical sensors. If it is a microwave based satellite, then we need a radar for imaging, we need scatterometer, we need altimeter, so many sensors. They are all called payload. Now, payload data handling system. Payload data handling system means whatever data is given by the sensors. Now, so many people may be having that digital electronics as your optional subjects. So the payload data are coming in the form of huge packed data. Those things are to be arranged in space. It is in terms of gigabits or megabits, depends upon the sensor. Radar data has got very high volume, and it has to be transmitted through a data transmitter to ground. Suppose if the spacecraft is not visible, but it is supposed to image some other countries or some other region which is not visible to India, all the data will be sent to onboard a solid state recorder, and finally it is transmitted whenever it is visible to our ground stations in India. So generally it shows that what are the satellite components or subsystems present in the total satellite. Now, whatever I have told right now, now you can make out, these are the solar panels what I am showing, and some of the mechanism what we have, and this is one antenna. These are the sensors which will see the star, and it will, with respect to that reference, it will give the coordinates. And all systems are housed within the structure. Now, again, further details. So whatever you are seeing, the right side, that is nothing but your the optical sensors. You know, visible band, we have studied IR band, visible band and all. So each camera will have its one band. I think I am disturbing. One band. So then this left side, what you are seeing is nothing but wheels, actuators to get the stability. And what you are seeing here is all the electronic systems are put together, and it will go inside the chamber for testing purpose. This is some more system. This is onboard computer, whatever you are seeing. It has got mainly ASICs, FPGAs, and many, many high-speed devices, and memories, so many things. And what you... Sorry, very sorry. And what you are seeing is nothing but the batteries. Down, what you are seeing is batteries. Now, this is a disassembled view of the spacecraft. The center is the structure, what you are seeing. It has got different panels. All small electronic boxes are integrated with these panels, and this is a solar panel, and this is the antenna. This is a radar imaging satellite, that's why I have put. Sorry for the disturbance, okay. Okay. Now, if you see, whatever I have shown in the disassembled view, if you integrate everything, you will get the final spacecraft. These are all just to give you some idea to follow my lecture. This stowed configuration, when it is put in space, after deployment, the satellite looks like this. Okay, now we are going ahead with our presentation topic, how it is being realized. So before starting the realization, how the satellite work commence means, to start with, first the user or nation will come with their requirement. That requirement has been analyzed by a study committee. The study committee will work out what are the feasible possibilities, and the report will be submitted to Parliament. The Parliament has to approve it. Further, after the approval, the budget will be sanctioned. Once the budget is sanctioned, then the project team will be formed. The project team then finally will take up the work, individual responsibilities, and they have to go ahead with your with their draft design. So once the design is completed, it is called a baseline design. It will be reviewed accordingly. The recommendations will be given. Then they will go for prototype model. In that, they will again do the test, present the results. So it will be an iteration. Then finally, they will go ahead with the engineering model. With engineering model, it is called preliminary design. Preliminary design review will be completed. Once it is approved with all recommendations, then we will go for flight packages realization. So once the flight packages are realized, they are all delivered to, these are the flight packages, they are all delivered to integration section. Then all small packages have been integrated with, you see the harness, whatever we are using, and this is the structure, what you are seeing at the right side. So the panel, the consists of all the subsystems, finally it will be integrated with the structure. Now, when we are in disassemble mode, what we will look at? So we see, for example, power and communication systems, I have explained, they have to talk to each other. So we have to verify the interfaces, number one. Number two, electrical test. If you would have studied a transmitter. If you see transmitter, what are the important parameters of the transmitter? The transmitter has to give the proper output. So we have to verify whether it is giving proper output, whether the voltage specification specified for the transmitter. Maybe it may need around plus or minus 5 volts, plus or minus 15 volts, and total what is the thermal power dissipated, all the parameters will be verified. This is for only one system I am speaking. It similar things will be done for the, slide whatever I have shown for all the systems. If it has got the software, we have to verify for all software. When we tell about verification, it is not only for positive checks, what is intended to be done. We will go for negative checks also. So all software, we verify for our negative checks also. And both hardware and software interaction will be verified with respect to logics. So all those things are verified independently, assembled on the panels. Once everything is completed, then it will be ready for assemble mode. So assemble mode means once when the committee approves all, there is no deviation, everything is meeting its requirement, there is no problem. Then what happens? We all will assemble the panels to the structure and finally it will take its shape. Again, we have to do the verification of interfaces because to understand whether any human error has happened or whether any cable shortage is there, or sometimes what happens, this is a very crucial test phase. When everything is coming together, you can have EMI, EMC interferences and other type of spikes in the power line. There are so many interferences. So this will cause a bit error in your digital portion. So all the interfaces have to be verified and it has to be verified for its specification. The same test, whatever we have done in disassemble mode, will be repeated in assemble mode also. Now, the satellite is ready. Before it is, one phase is over. Next one, each system is designed for a design parameters. Let us take temperature. For example, if you take a transmitter, receiver, or any electronics package, we will define the temperature, that is to work from minus 10 degree to plus 50 degree. Why it is from minus 10 to 50? Because in space, the temperatures seen by the electrical subsystems will vary with respect to a spacecraft orientation, with respect to its position in the space. There are so many things. So to test whether the particular system is working within the limit or not in the integrated way, we have got one thermovacuum test. In that thermovacuum test, the whole spacecraft is put inside the chamber. The chamber is closed. They will create vacuum condition inside the chamber, and many heaters are put to vary the temperatures from minus 10 to plus 50. This generally in the test will be carried out for 30 days and 24/7. We used to go in shifts round the clock to verify the performance of the spacecraft. We should closely monitor all the parameters. Any spacecraft will have around 4,500 parameters or 5,000 parameters. All the parameters are coming in digital stream. These parameters are received in data acquisition system, and it is stripped according to the format, and it will be processed. Mainly it is like some parameters are analog type, some parameters are digital type, and based on the parameters value, we ascertain whether the transmitter behaves all right or sensor behaves all right, whether power system electronics is okay or not, what is the battery voltage. So many informations we used to get from the data, and it has to be continuously monitored. Once it is ready, then it will be allowed to go for the next phase test. Now, next phase test is nothing but solar panel deployment. We expect after assembling all the hardware, we want it to be deployed in spacecraft. So we have to create a zero G condition in ground to verify whether the spacecraft is, solar panel is working all right or not. So by giving a command, a pyro will be operated, and from that the command will be given to open the, deploy the panel. Whatever you are seeing, it is nothing but a zero G fixture. It will give the zero G effect for the panel as if it is in space. We have to verify for the successful of the test. Then we have to see end to end test. For example, sensor, we simulate the error in sensor. Accordingly, the wheel has to rotate. Whether it is giving response or not will be studied during the test. And that transmitter and other things and all will be connected at the end. So once we will have one radiation test space to see the continuity from transmitter to antenna, it is called radiation test. And another special test is EMIFC test, where all systems will be put on. And we will see whether any bit error is coming, whether any sensors is malfunctioning. All other interference studies will be conducted in the special test. Now, finally, what happened? The satellite will be ready. Each phase will be subjected to strict monitoring and also data review by the review board. And accordingly, whatever recommendations given by the board to be strictly followed, and it should be complied with. Now, before moving to Sriharikota, whatever you are seeing is nothing but the vehicle interface. Now, this is the adapter what you are seeing. This adapter is with a vehicle, launch vehicle. We will like to see the compatibility with the spacecraft ring. Then this is one big test. This has to also to be passed. But before doing the test, we would have done on paper so many analysis, so many requirements and specifications and all used to be thoroughly verified. And finally, it will be approved for this meeting. And with this, we have to find out whether it is successful or not. Now, so once it is ready. Now you can see this is the transportation container which carries the spacecraft. The transportation container also, it is a very big system. It has to carefully handle the spacecraft from Bangalore to Sriharikota, and it is taken there. Then it will be integrated with the launch vehicle and it will be launched. So finally, so once when it is in space, after the solar panels are deployed. We will go for on-orbit auto operation, and there are so many sequence of operations expected automatically. Earth acquisition, it has immediately see the earth using earth sensor, and that time what happened, the transmitter has to send the data to ground. It is called it has to see the earth, and it has to, I mean, for solar panel operation it has to see the sun, so we call it as earth and sun acquisition. Now once it is in space, we have got the control center. As I told, it will be controlled by the center, which will continuously monitoring the health of the spacecraft, and it will do the maintenance operation by giving commands and seeing the telemetry data. If any systems to be calibrated in space, it will be done. Now once everything is ready, now people will give the, I mean, the next sequence of operation is we have to put on the sensor. If it is a communication satellite, we will begin the services of television operation, I mean broadcasting television signals or media signals or whatever it is. And if it is a remote sensing, it will take the image and send the data to ground. As space exploration means it will do, again, it will do send the science data after taking the images. This is one simple example how the satellite, wherever we want to take the image, the satellite, it will be programmed. So whenever the satellite passes over the region, it will send the signal, or it will, if it is a radar, if it is optical remote sensing, it will take the photograph of the place which we are interested. So once the data is taken, it is formatted in onboard, and it is simultaneously it will transmit to ground. So now you see, once the data is over on ground, we process the data and we will get the image like this. Now once it is in orbit, we will continue the satellite health control by putting off heaters, putting on the heaters, conditioning the battery voltage. We do the regular payload operation, and on orbit status is reviewed periodically, and finally, if the performance is pakka, everything is good, its life is determined by the fuel availability with the spacecraft. Whatever you are seeing the picture now, it is nothing but fuel tank. Now we will go to the application. Now quickly I will cover it. So generally, how we will classify the spacecraft or types of the satellite? If you see, we have got communication satellite, remote sensing satellite, under remote sensing satellite. It can be optical remote sensing, microwave remote sensing, or scientific mission, or it may be for military purpose, or it may be for astronomy satellite, and it is a navigation satellite. It can be an interplanetary mission, weather satellite, or it can be a cargo, which takes the resources to the space station, and it can be a space station. Now, how the satellites are classified? First, it starts with application. From application, people will decide which orbit it has to be. People will decide which sensor we have to use, and what will be the orbit and altitude, which frequency band we have to select for operation, whether it will be visible, whether it will be IR, as far as optical remote sensing is concerned. If it is a communication satellite, we will see whether it will be a C band, or whether it is a extended C band, or whether it is a Ku band or Ka band. So many things are there. And if the size of the satellite determines, tells, if it is less than 1 kg, it is called nanosatellite. If it is less than 100 kg, it is called a cube satellite. If it is less than 400 kg, it is small satellite. Like that depends upon the size we define the satellites. And size also being determined, the life. Then finally, what happened? The size, sometimes the fuel tank, whatever it carries, determines its life. These are the parameters which will control the spacecraft. Now generally I have put some of the spacecraft in the past, and the assembled configuration, all the spacecrafts will look like this. See, application wise I am going to limit to the satellites whatever we have launched from ISRO. I am proud to cover all the satellites in different categories. Whatever we have launched worked very well, and it has given enough applications to the user community in the society. So generally, application-wise, satellite applications, it is a vast area. Many countries are using the spacecraft for many applications. I am restricting to our own satellites and our own applications, what we have achieved. Now, simple thing, we will start with communication satellite, very, very simple slide only. The thing is that suppose if you want to transmit a signal from here to A to B, it's not possible because of the geometry of this Earth. So for that, we send the signal to spacecraft, and the spacecraft will send back to the signal to a receive station. So the communication satellite is nothing but a relay station. It is has its own transponder. The transponder receives the signals from the station A and translates and sends back to station B. Because of that, the communication is possible from station A to station B. Now, generally, communication satellites are artificial satellites. The whatever I have told, that relay receives signals from an Earth station and it is transmit to other Earth stations. See, the thing is, one advantage is it can be a point-to-point communication or point-to-multipoint communication also. So generally, this type of communication to be constant with the, the source and destination should be always getting the communication 100%. That's why the communication satellites, always they are put in a geostationary orbit. Geostationary orbit means that satellite will look at a particular location of the Earth continuously 24/7. So it means if the Earth is moving 24/7, the same thing will be also synchronized with the Earth, and the satellite also will move continuously, so that one point on Earth will be continuously visible to spacecraft. Now, communication satellite, further if you classify, it can be used for fixed satellite service. That means one point to one point, no other stations will receive it. Now, broadcast, BSS, broadcast satellite service means, example, a TV. From one station, many users, many home will receive the information. It is called a broadcast satellite service. And it can be for meteorology purpose. And mobile communication is also coming under that communication satellite applications. Data relay transmission. Data relay transmission means if you want to know the temperature of a small place, maybe around some 10,000 or 20,000 small stations, all will be transmitted to spacecraft. The spacecraft in turn collect all the information and it will send it to the meteorology department in Delhi. So that particular transponder is called a data relay transponder. Search and rescue, whenever a person or any, maybe mainly it is used in plane and ship and other forest tracking purpose and all, people will have one small transmitter. If any problem is there, that information will be sent to spacecraft, easily accessible. From there, it will go to the corresponding receive station. These are the communication satellite applications. Now, the mobile, whatever I have explained to know, the spacecraft is in space. It can have communication with other systems like vehicles, ships, aircraft, and it can have communication to people in the other part of the world also. So they are coming under mobile satellite. Now you can ask me, what is the difference? Even though when I am talking about so many classifications, see, it depends upon, you must be, the fixed satellite service, there's a limited bandwidth. The bandwidth is internationally allotted one agency is there, they allot the band. So the transponder, what happened, based on the applications, it has got its own bandwidth, own frequency. For example, mobile communication can be operated only in S band. FSS can be operated only in C band. like that, not each service will have its own allocation of band and bandwidth. Based on that only the applications will differ. Otherwise, all are same. Now we'll go to quickly remote sensing satellite. Remote sensing satellite, generally it is put in polar orbit. What do you mean by polar orbit? The satellite will move from north to south continuously. So whenever the Earth is moving, the satellite will have its own path. So it covers the total area of the Earth. Now it can be an active sensor or passive sensor. What do you mean by passive? Passive means when sunlight is falling on the ground, the reflected signal is received by the sensor and the data is sent back to Earth station. So it can see what is the image or what is the nature of the terrain. And the active sensor means if there is no sun, imagine no illumination, it has to map some of the things. Means it sends a signal, gets a reflected signal back. Again, it is sending back to the receive station. This is mainly useful for night imaging. Mainly, it is used in for a defense purpose. Now, this is one simple plot what I have given. Just see, left side is a resolution y-axis, and right side is the from 1960 onwards how the resolution has improved. Now, 2010 we have come more or less to 1 meter. Now already 20 years we have crossed. Now you can imagine, I am leaving to the listener, we are capable of taking images, I mean the world, I am telling, in terms of centimeters, in the order of 25 or 20. Now what do you mean by remote sensing? Means a remote sensing instrument collects information about an object. Earth observation satellite used for observing the Earth surface safety and quality of our life. It can be in geo or polar orbit. Mainly it is in polar orbit. It has got varieties of application. For example, it is used for in agriculture for crop inventory, yield prediction, soil and crop condition monitoring. Geology purpose, it will go for oil, mineral and gas exploration activities, cartography, town planning. And environment wise, it is a climate study. Defense and security, it can go for generation of maps, target monitoring, and also detection. This is what I have spoken right now is for remote sensing. One simple example. Now you are very quiet. Commonly, we are hearing about forest fire throughout the world, many places, each country. So we want to estimate what is the forest fire and how much damage has happened. How to map that, how to manage these things, all those things are done using remote sensing data. And before going to the slide, I would like to see, the thing is, if you see a farmer, if he sees the field, his view will be like this. Suppose if the satellite sees, it can see the broader area. And if you see the processed data, it will look like this. Finally, what happens? If the user or the application scientist look into that, he can tell where exactly the plants are being damaged or being affected, or the overall picture of the particular area will be sensed by the application engineer. Now, that's only what I have told. This weed development, if anything is there, it can be easily located with the satellite picture. And any disease, if it is seen on any field, it can be looked nicely. And suppose the same remote sensing data, if we want to do indirectly, it comes for town planning or something like that. And suppose we happen to have different type of sensors. For example, radar, if you have IR sensors, if you have visible sensor, all sensors, if you integrate, it is called mosaicing, like mosaic. So if you mosaic all the data together, we will get multi-resolutions and varieties of data, which will be useful for many application engineers. This urban tree succession, mainly town planning, water extraction. Okay, now we have completed remote sensing. Now we are in AstroSat. In AstroSat, what happened? We have launched AstroSat. India has launched AstroSat, and even today it is working very well in space. And we could, I can observe some 3 or 4 events which happened in space. The X-ray means what happened? We have got enough expertise in low wavelength X-ray, high wavelength X-ray, high field X-ray, low field X-ray. There are so many things, and we have got expertise in that. And it gives us the space activities. Now and then what is happening, and the Hubble telescope is one of the example for this particular type of application. It has enabled scientists to see the many things. Now, navigation satellite. Navigation satellite, all of you know, we used to follow GPS. Now India has got its own NAVIC. It has put around 8 or 9 satellites in space. The position of person, the position of any object is determined from the distance measured from these satellites. We need minimum 4 satellites to determine the position of the receiver on the Earth. And the navigation satellite wise, if you see, we have got GPS by US, GLONASS by Russian, this one. And IRNSS by India, and ESA is also having its own constellation, and it is used to, you know, generally the receivers are put in automobiles, aircraft, boats, ships, heavy equipment, wherever it is. In fact, it is being used in spacecraft also to determine the position of the spacecraft. Now, weather satellite. You know, we have got luxury of having our mobile and all media related applications, but today the worrying factor is weather. We would like to know what is the situation of ice conditions in the polar regions, how it melts, and what is the pollution of the air quality and other things. So it's in future, these are all gaining our attention. So this is geostationary satellite, even the polar satellite, they are used for observing all those things. Here, the microwave sensors like radar or RISAT, whatever, when someone introduced me, they told RISAT. It is nothing but radar imaging satellite. The radar imaging satellite plays an important role in supporting the weather-related information. Now, coming back to interplanetary missions. You must be aware, we were very much successful in launching Chandrayaan 1. Using that, we are able to, by keeping some of the remote sensing payload on board, we are able to detect whether water is there or not on the moon. Followed by, we have got Chandrayaan 2. Chandrayaan also, orbiter is going around the moon. Now Chandrayaan 3 is getting ready. And you know, MOM was very much successful. That is, mission to Mars. It carried minimum some 15 instruments. These 15 instruments are used for, some are synthetic aperture radar type, some are optical sensors type, some are that X-ray payload detections, some are to understand the geological condition of the Mars surface. So there are all these instruments worked very well, and we could get very much potential data from the spacecraft. And right now, mission to Venus is also getting, in the steady phase. Now, what is ahead? Just we will see the space. You know that there is no limit for any applications in space. A lot more to be understood, to be studied. That is for the mankind purpose only, betterment of mankind. And in future, we may look for so many space probes to various planets. For example, US and other countries, they started sending space probes to, in fact, our Jupiter, Mercury, Venus. There are so many probes already have gone there, and they are able to send some useful data also. And we are also in the pipeline to do the same work. And now we have got Gaganyaan, that is manned mission, is coming up. International Space Station, all of you are aware, it has been working for so many years. Right now, I came to know that another 6 or 8 months, the life will be over, and China has started its own space station. It's right now for all other countries, it's a time to look into their new station in space. Now, space tourism, you are all aware that we people are, very much familiar of this space tourism, like every week people are going and coming. It's like, I don't know what to tell, it's like a town bus nowadays. So, it is going to take its own place in future, and robotics and artificial intelligence in space. That is also going to have its own, potential in all space technology. Then that lander and rover, if you see, wherever the space probes are going, they are carrying lander and rover. Using those things, we are able to directly have touch with that particular planet. And you know that recently US has sent Perseverance to Mom, and it is flying its own helicopter there. You see the technology, good. So it is in demand, and defense application, you know, to save our country, we have got our own requirements. And right now, we are not able to visualize what will happen in future at any time, breakthrough demands or any new findings or any new technology, we should be in a position to gear up with that. And if you see, in the future, imagine only satellites will play a role. If you want to have a vehicle operated without a driver, and for that, what is in demand is we should go for varieties of sensors, technologies, applications. All those things are in your hands. Whomever is doing their studies, young generation, they should look for all these things. Just only part we can lay to you people, and you over 60-70 years, how we have got this much progress, we should aim from here onwards what we are going to achieve. Now, I have shown so many space agencies are there. We are all in competition. India has to come up with its own strength. And in future, we will be looking for ocean data and Earth atmosphere, which is very important. So it will send in terms of terabytes of data. And we have got so many receivers. All the data to be data processed. That is very important. The data processing is a demanding task. Now, while processing the data, the background of your science, the background of your mathematical strength, algorithm development will give wide varieties of applications. Application, there is no limit. Using this strength, we should derive varieties of application from the available data. Then we should look for so many satellites. It's a satellite constellation, and we have to go for formation flying technique, simultaneously some 3 or 4 satellites, how the birds are flying, no? How they are flying? Similar way, we have to fly the spacecraft, and we should have the area of coverage more, and we should do some docking type of experiment in spacecraft. And when we launch the spacecraft, there is a worry that it should not be accounted in debris. Once the life is over, we should have a proper mechanism to bring back to Earth. And of course, as I told, space probes. Right now, Venus's study is going on. Mars already achieved. Jupiter is already achieved. We have gone to Jupiter moon also. Saturn is also. People are trying. And asteroid also. Some already have been launched. So much stock is there in hand, and younger generation has to gear up to fulfill the needs. Now, my point of view, again, I am stressing, this is a conclusion part. The operation satellites provide many of the services in our life. See, if you imagine today, we cannot live without mobile. So It is very difficult to imagine that without satellites, whether we can live or not, because satellite has played a major role in our day-to-day applications. So its service should continue. And today, a strong foundation is being laid by Indian Space Program. We have got enough technologies, enough experts, enough experience. We should move forward. And I have seen we all have a strong participation in any project with the team spirit and also with patriotism. And finally, I request all the people, the science and technology to be used for the benefit of mankind. So thanks for patience and listening. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was really very informative, yeah, and we have learned a lot from this.
Yeah.
We have like many questions from the participants here.
Welcome.
The questions you can see in the chat box here. These are the questions which are from our participants from YouTube stream.
Okay.
So the question is, like, what was the motivation behind ISRO's reason to finally open up to a private sector? Is it related to the rising success of private space organizations around the world?
Actually, it's a good question. The thing is, I will put it in simple way. See, today the demand may be more. Okay, if the demand is not met, is not able to meet by ISRO, of course you assume. Then private sectors can play a role. That is number one. Number two, some of the things, if it is in the production form, ISRO is mainly for research and organization. They can look for new technologies, new sensors, new applications. So once it is proved, it can be offloaded to private people so that they can do the realization in industry form or something like that. The third one is we are engaging all the people in particular, in a particular activity towards nation's requirement. I think these are the factors are taken into consideration for this topic. I feel this is my view. Maybe different views may be there. This is my view. Because basically we are R&D organization, research and development. So we should keep on doing the research and find out new technologies and offload the repeat systems to private industries.
Thank you, ma'am. Actually, one more follow-up to this, ma'am. Like, we all know about Elon Musk and he's doing a great job nowadays in this field. So how is it actually different from the work in ISRO? Like,
are talking about the navigation satellite, GLONASS.
In the SpaceX and other technologies that related to space he's doing right now.
Who that SpaceX you are talking?
Yeah, ma'am, like Elon Musk
Elon Musk, okay. See, Elon, see, our country, no, we are looking for only benefit of the mankind. That only is underlined one. Our space activity, when it was originated, it was with the purpose that it would be useful to our society. So that was our motive and the prime goal also. See, Elon Musk, he can do so. As a private person, he has the freedom to do anything. But after some time, what happened, you know, if the need comes, arises in our country, it will be taken. It's not a problem. He and ISRO cannot be compared.
Yes, ma'am.
We are government organization. We have to look after our own nation and our own people and the services for them.
Thank you, ma'am. We totally agree to that.
Yeah.
So we have another question, ma'am. Like, space debris will become a huge problem in the future. So yes. Is there any initiative by, you know, ISRO to reduce that?
See, actually what happened, it cannot be done by an individual agency. I think there is a one big forum or one agency internationally working towards that. And many space agencies are the members of the particular body. Periodically, they meet and they work out some plan. And each satellite is built up with a re-entry program. So once the life is over, there is a proposal to bring back the spacecraft on its own to Earth so that on the way it will get burnt or something like that. There is a big body existing which is working on this particular topic for many years. We are party to that. We are also one of the members.
Yes, ma'am. So the next question is, ma'am, what type of insulation material is actually used to protect the satellite from external space?
See, insulation material means what happened. External space, what type of interferences you will have? See, for example, sun load will be there. To avoid that sun load, we used to have MLA, that is multi-layer insulation blankets or something like that. Yellow color, whatever you have seen in that photograph, whatever I have shown, no? That is one of the isolation material. Then we have got one OSR. OSR means if any heat is there inside the spacecraft, it will not allow that to come out. That is also one of the insulation from spacecraft to outside, it will not come. And we used to have some type of paints to take care of them. Mainly thermal control purpose only, we used to use the insulators.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. And one more question, ma'am. Which satellites are best to monitor the weather of Indian regions?
Radar imaging satellite is the best satellite to measure the meteorological conditions of, why India? Any country. Because weather means what happened? Rain. Mainly you would like to know when the rain will come. That mainly because of the cloud. We are unable to take the photograph with respect, I mean, using optical sensor. That time only radar will give the best solution for that particular weather monitoring purpose.
Okay, ma'am. So there is one more question, ma'am. Like Chandrayaan 2 and Mangalyaan, the images from both, that is amount of pictures.
Yeah.
It is actually very less compared to the NASA, you know, what it gets. So,
okay.
Why is it so, ma'am?
Oh, no. The thing is, you cannot authentically tell it is less. I also cannot tell. You understood that? Because no one knows how much data people are receiving, how much data is being processed, how much it can be sent outside. There are so many factors involved in that. So we cannot conclude and data is less or something like that. It is all some policies.
Yes, ma'am, totally.
But data are available.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you for the information, ma'am. Mm. And we also have, what are the advantages of geostationary satellites for remote imaging?
Remote imaging, what will happen, no? That's the best. Because I told you, no, any particular area, mainly what happened if it is in geostationary orbit, we can locate it towards our Earth so that always it can see the Earth. That is the best satellite. Coverage is more. Main is coverage is more. Optical remote sensing means you need many satellites to cover a big area. Whereas a GEO, it can cover at a time huge area. Big advantage. But what is the disadvantage? So if you want to take the image from GEO, you can use two type of sensors. One is optical sensor. The optical sensor at the 36,000 kilometer, whether the radiation from ground will be effective to reach the sensor, that we have to study. Suppose if it is a radar imaging satellite, you have to pump that much power from 36 kilometer to ground, then it has to reflect back. Whether you are capable of generating that much RF power in spacecraft to get back the wanted signal, wanted reflected signal from ground. So these are the disadvantages with respect to realization of the spacecraft. However, a geostationary imaging satellite is more advantageous compared to optical because the area of coverage is more.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, now I would like to request our lecturers ask you any questions if they have.
Yeah, open.
Vandita, can I tell you?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Okay. It's totally yours.
Okay, thank you, madam. Myself, Dr. Sudarshan.
Yeah.
I teach control systems and robotics. And yeah, and we also do some space related activities. Like actually, Dr. Rangarajan is our mentor.
Oh, so, my regards to Dr. Rangarajan.
Yes,
yeah.
He only recommended your name for this event.
Yeah.
So last time also we did one workshop on nanosatellite.
Yeah.
So we had Dr. Vinod Kumar from Jivar Rao Center and Ravi Kumar, Pichaimani sir. So they all had come. So
they're all controls engineer.
Right.
Yeah, I worked with those people. Kindly go ahead.
Hopefully we will invite you physically to our campus next time.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So I think you can enlighten our students also about the Earth observation satellite, what was its capabilities, and how much time it will take to rebuild another EOS. So if you can please enlighten.
Yeah, whatever presentation I made, each satellite, each slide can be presented for half an hour. That much information is available.
Right,
since I am covering end to end, in order to get a hold on the total topic, I just touched upon important points only, but heavy stuff is available. It can be taken up. There is no problem. But it will be very much interesting.
Yeah, Earth observation satellite, the one.
Yeah.
Okay.
It can be done.
Can you just tell us how much time for the ISRO to build another EOS it will take?
I will put some questions to you. I will answer to your you wanted the information. I have told you, the classification of satellite, it has got a nano. I think it comes under the category of nano CubeSat, small satellite, big satellite.
Bigger satellite. Yeah.
Okay. Now, that sensor also you must be knowing. The thing is, sensor means again it can be a visible region sensor, IR region, and we have got radar remote sensing and scatterometer, altimeter. Okay. Now, practically speaking, I will put it in different categories. One is, if you want to repeat the spacecraft, whatever we have made, it takes 1 year.
Okay.
This is number one. Number two, you assume everything is available, and we have to make the spacecraft. T0, if you start, it takes minimum 2 years, because all, if it is a new spacecraft, definitely you need varieties of models, and it has to be verified, qualified, reviewed, recommendations to be adapted. Sometimes it has to call for new fabrication, new process technology. There are so many things, but optimum way, if you want to want me to tell, it will take minimum 2 or 3 years. Okay, the third category is, you are selecting a sensor. The sensor needs a particular component, some devices. If it has got difficulty in procurement, because they themselves, they have to do some qualification. You got the point.
Right.
So the delays may be due to so many reasons. Okay, the third category. The fourth category, suppose in a normal working conditions, you know what type of priority which country needs, what type of demand will come. Okay, so based on that also, the schedule will get adjusted. So there are varieties of scenarios. If you define one particular thing, then we can tell how much time it will take. So depends upon the scenario, the realization schedule will differ.
Okay.
You got the point?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Thank you.
So, sir, if it's over, we have one last question from participants.
Yeah.
actually, ma'am, how this clock system actually works in a satellite?
Which clock?
Clock system, like the general.
How... Reference, no? That's why I told, no? The onboard computer.
Yes, ma'am.
Onboard computer has got one, it's a clock. See, in fact, if you ask, all systems know they have got their own clock system internal to their package, whether it is a digital or whether it is a star sensor or whether it is any electronic system, it has it is a digital electronic system, it has got its own clock source for its reference. Finally, what happened? We all synchronize the clock available clock sources on the spacecraft to onboard computer clock, and that will be taken as the reference for us. Hope you asked only this clock.
Yes, ma'am.
So it used to be synchronized with the onboard computer clock.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Now I would request Sudhanwar to take over the session.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. I'm Sudhanwar, Joint Secretary of WSJC. I would like to start by extending my heartfelt thanks to Mrs. N. Madarmati, ex-Deputy Director ISRO. Thank you, ma'am, for taking time out of your busy schedule for this talk and imparting knowledge to us. I'm sure all of us here benefited immensely by listening to this talk. Next, I want to thank Dr. M. G. Veena, Branch Counselor, IEEE-SJC, for moderating this talk. We truly appreciate your efforts to make this talk possible. I would like to express my gratitude to our WA advisor, Professor Suprita M. Thank you, ma'am, for all your help and support in organizing this event. Next, I would like to thank Dr. Sudarshan Patil Kulkarni, Vice Chairperson, IEEE Mysore Subsection, for his presence here today and his continuous support to IEEE-SJC. I thank all the distinguished invites present here accepting our invitation. We are grateful to you for attending today's talk. Finally, I want to thank the audience for their presence here today at this virtual gathering. With your continued support, we hope to bring you many such talks in the near future. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you.
All the best. All the best to all. Thank you. Well.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks to all.
Thank you, everyone. So we have many events coming up in a future by IEEE-SJC. So I would request all of you to follow the IEEE account on Instagram and stay tuned. And thank you for attending. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.